the great dam has triumphed over all difficulties. Several thousand people had assembled for the very big event, the official opening.
After more than 60 years of service, the Kariba Dam is failing. This huge monster, built on the Zambezi River, cost an astonishing $480 million. The dam is located between the South African nations of Zambia and Zimbabwe and generates power for both. The Zambezi is Africa's fourth largest river. Its drainage basin covers an area slightly less than half of the Nile's. To the natives, it made sense to harvest the potential of the Zambezi River and generate hydroelectricity. The region where the dam is located was a federal colony within the British Empire. Orders for its construction were given in 1955 and subsequently completed in 1958. The late Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, officially opened the dam in 1960. The success of the Kariba Dam was the shining beacon of hope for South Africa. Utilizing the generated energy, South Africa was able to industrialize and provide a better lifestyle to its citizens. The dam has a generation capacity of 1,050 megawatts for Zimbabwe, while it generates an estimated 1,080 megawatts for Zambia. But in recent years, it's been falling short of its commitment. Because of droughts and the low inflows from tributaries feeding the Zambezi River, Kariba's water levels have decreased, causing the dam to reduce its power production. Both Zambia and Zimbabwe heavily rely on this dam for the majority of its energy needs. So when power production declined, both countries had to introduce power cuts. Six-hour-long power cuts started in Zambia in December last year, while Zimbabwe was already facing 19 hours of load shedding daily, with devastating effects on all aspects of life in the country. Electricity's turned back on between approximately midnight and 5 a.m. Kariba Dam generates half of the energy needed for Zimbabwe. Its lowered output has sent shockwaves throughout the economy, causing the closure of small businesses and affecting hospitals, industries, and everyday life. The dam's failure, combined with the low performance of its aging coal-fired plants, means that Zimbabwe is producing less than half of its 1,700 megawatt power demand. More than 8 million Zimbabweans do not have access to power. Electricity demand has surged in recent years, driven by higher agricultural and mining activity. To bridge the gap between demand and supply, the country has to import power from its regional neighbors, Zambia and Mozambique. This power is costly and adds financial strain to an already struggling nation. To resolve the energy crisis, China has partnered with the Zimbabwean government to install solar power panels. But these aren't some ordinary panels spread over a wide expanse of land. Instead, these will be floating on Lake Kariba. How will the floating panels facilitate the dam, and will they be able to pull Zimbabwe out of the energy crisis? Watch this video to the end to find out. If you haven't subscribed to our channel, you're missing out on two incredible videos each week. Let's return to the topic. Chinese company, China Energy Engineering Corp., has proposed the construction of a 1,000 megawatt floating solar plant on the Kariba Dam along the Zambezi River. If the proposal is granted, then China Energy Corp. will install more than 1.8 million photovoltaic panels over 146 modular floating units. The reported cost of this project is around $1 billion. The civil engineering works are going to cost around $186 million, while the cost of the installation alone has been pegged at $801 million. The project is mostly financed by the African banks under the flagship of the Africa Investment Forum. But why is Zimbabwe choosing floating solar panels over other green options? The first reason is that floating panels save land, which can be later used for housing or other industrial needs. Unlike wind plants and dams, there's no need to displace the native population as the project is restricted to water only. Secondly, solar and hydro are seasonal generators. During the wet season, dams operate at their maximum capacity, while on the other hand, hot seasons are best for solar production. In this way, they both complement each other, producing electricity round the clock and minimizing power cuts. For drought-prone regions like Zimbabwe, solar panels spread across the water surface to help minimize evaporation. Less evaporation ensures that there's sufficient water in the reservoir for the dam for people and other commercial needs. As the solar wafers would be floating on water, the water provides natural cooling, which tends to increase its efficiency. They also limit algae growth, providing necessary shelter for fish and other marine life. There are also plans to breed fish under the floating solar panels. Let's discuss how these floating panels would work in the first place. During the day, when there's maximum light, solar energy would be utilized. The dam's sluice gates will remain closed, allowing the water to collect behind the dam's wall. At night, when the water has reached a maximum level, the dam's gates are open, thereby creating hydropower. In this way, Kariba will have a 24-hour electricity production nonstop. Installing solar panels near existing hydro plants is a smart move, as it cuts down transmission costs. As the transmission equipment is already available on site, there's no need to build it from scratch. The main consumers of this electricity would be the mining companies. Zimbabwe holds 553 million tons of proven coal reserves as of 2016, ranking 38th in the world. In a bid to step up its energy production, the government has also rehabilitated the Hwang Power Station with a cost of $1.5 billion. 85% of this funding came from China. Two units of 300 megawatts were installed, bringing the new generation capacity to 600 megawatts. The old thermal units at Hwang, commissioned between 1983 and 1987, frequently break down and are performing below capacity. However, for long-term energy security, the Zimbabwean government is hoping to shift to renewable energy like the rest of the world. The National Renewable Energy Policy aims to produce 1,100 megawatts by 2025 and 2,100 by 2030. After Zimbabwe's falling out with Western allies, the country has adopted a look-east policy. There's no better partner than China, which is the most experienced in the renewable portfolio. In fact, the largest floating farm is the Dizhou Dingzhuang floating solar farm in China. The 320-megawatt solar plant sits on a reservoir near a coal-fired plant and a wind farm. The combined output of both solar and wind is fed into a grid from where it is transported to various uses. Beyond the solar integration with the Kariba Dam, the dam itself is undergoing massive rehabilitation. Routine checkups identify two areas that need to be repaired ASAP. They are the plunge pool and the dam sluice gates. As you can imagine, a task like this will take many years of hard work and extraordinary engineering, all coming for a $294 million price tag. The rehabilitation works are being funded by multiple donors like the European Union, World Bank, African Development Bank, the government of Sweden, and the Zambezi River Authority through grants and loans. The plunge pool is a depression formed in land due to the pressure of water falling from a height. They're commonly found in waterfalls and dams. The heavy spillage of water has eroded the natural riverbed downstream. The pressure of the water has deepened the pool, causing the swirling of water and restricting its smooth flow. If left like this, the hole could also creep toward the dam's foundations. To resolve this issue, engineers have decided to excavate the pool and increase its area, allowing water to flow smoothly. To do this, engineers have to create a dry working site by pumping out all the water and creating a cofferdam. Cofferdam is a temporary workspace created during dam construction. It's later blasted once the work is finished. The vertical columns or piers are built on land before being transported downstream where the plunge pool is located. Once all the pieces are assembled, they're filled with concrete to strengthen the wall further. Between the columns, watertight metal gates are placed to secure the place. Next, water is slowly pumped out of the plunge pool to create a dry area. To widen the pool's area, controlled blasting is employed to loosen the mud. Steps are also created on the sides of the pool so that trucks and other equipment can access the site. The side closer to the dam's foundations lined with reinforced concrete to prevent erosion of its foundations. Once the plunge pool is reshaped, the metal gates are lifted, allowing water to fill the previous cofferdam. The expected time span is 3 years for fully renovated the plunge pool. Second, we have Kariba Dam's floodgate. Six sluice gates form the spillway from which Lake Kariba is released downstream once the reservoir reaches its maximum height. The concrete used inside the gates has expanded as it's constantly exposed to water. The minimal expansion is natural and is expected. However, over a long period, the expansion could affect the smooth opening and closing of the gates and possibly cause the spillway gates to jam. There's a serious risk if the gates are jammed, either in closed or open positions. If the gates are jammed in an open position, a huge volume of water is lost through the reservoir, which in turn would cause the water level to increase downstream, damaging residents, properties, animals, and the environment. As you can expect, if the gates are slammed shut, the reservoir water levels will keep on rising and will eventually overtop the dam's wall. For this purpose, emergency backup gates would be installed in case any of them stopped working. Similar to the plunge pool refurbishment, a cofferdam is needed to create a dry workspace so that each gate can be modified one by one. cofferdam pieces are gradually lowered by a crane and assembled to create a wall between the water and the dam. The water trapped in the cofferdams pumped to create a water-free space where the motorized crane can work. In the final step, the motorized gantry crane will place the emergency gates in all six sluice gates. The crane in the cofferdam will later be disassembled to allow the normal functioning of the dam. It's expected that the refurbishment of both plunge pool and the gates will be completed by 2025. The new Kariba Dam, combined with its floating solar panels, is expected to change the landscape of Zimbabwe. Not only will they solve the crippling blackouts that the nation faces, but it'll also shift power dependency to renewable sources. As investors around the world prefer to invest in clean energy over fossil fuels, this is a good sign for Africa and the rest of the world. If you liked today's video, kindly drop a like and subscribe to our channel. What other energy projects should we discuss? Mention them in the comments section, and we'll see you in the next video.